watch it this afternoon.
Yeah, I see. To me, that's a hall of great, and Coming to America is a hall of very good.
Trading Places is, it's better. Eddie was hitting more home runs back then.
Yeah, yeah, it's all time. Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, Coming to America is not that movie. Although we seem to quote Coming to America more often, bizarrely. Okay, right. What else you got?
The Firm. It's Tom Cruise, 1993. He's a law student. It's based off the books. Who was the guy who wrote all those books?
John Grisham.
John Grisham. He was hot as a pistol back then. Everything he made got made into a movie. He goes to Memphis. He gets in with a shady law firm that represents the mob. The Firm. It was very big at the time. It made a truckload at the box office. It was, you know, not peak Tom Cruise, but it was right up there. Personally, when you see The Firm is going to be on, do you watch?
Never. Never. I don't think I've seen it since it came out. Do you watch it? Is it any good?
It's a little hokey. The writing's a little hokey. They put the right people in it. Getting Gene Hackman in was a nice move as one of the lawyers.
Yeah.
If it's on, if there's nothing on, and this is going to sound bad, but no, I really wouldn't stop to watch that movie.
No, it doesn't get a lot of play on cable either. The book is pretty amazing, by the way.
I know
John
Grisham's
because they're cheesy. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, John Grisham, he's doing good. All right, what's next?
I'm really curious about your reaction, my reaction to this one. There's Something About Mary, 1998, the Farrelly brothers, when they were young and up and coming. You had Cameron Diaz. You had, what's his name? Ben Stiller.
Yeah.
You had the cameo by Brett Favre. You had Chris Elliott, who was on the Letterman show. It was Woogie. And I'll say this. At the time, that's a hysterical movie when the first time you watch it.
Whoa. At the time? There's Something About Mary. That's in the canon. There's not even a second of doubt that is an all-time great comedy.
I knew you were going to defend this like you're defending a child.
Oh, my gosh. First of all, do you ever say anything ill about the Farrelly brothers, then we have to talk. They're geniuses, and that is the height, of, as you said, earlier in their career, but at the height of their powers.
Okay, I'll say this. This is the only criticism of Something About Mary. It's never as good as the first time you watch it, because the surprise things with, like, Warren and the thing, different things that happen in the movie, that the reactions, it's almost like shock comedy, I guess you'd call it. Remember when he's in the car with the guy and they're at the rest stop and all of a sudden, you know, what happens there in that scene?
Yeah.
When you know it's coming, it doesn't have the impact. It's still very funny and it's a very good movie and a classic comedy. But that is one of the movies, the first time you see it, I'll bet the theaters went crazy and you missed some lines of dialogue. You're laughing so hard.
Come back for the Matt Dillon performance and break down the Matt Dillon performance when he gets his teeth like whitened. Matt Dillon is so funny on a second watch of that movie. He is unbelievable. The very serious sort of like, you know, young heartthrob Matt Dillon is so amazing as a creep in that movie. But Cameron Diaz, delightful. And I'm just going to say it, Paul, delightful. I think that one is great.
If you had a Leisuremen draft of characters from movies for wives, like who you want to have to be your wife, Cameron Diaz is easily a one seed if there's four one seeds.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, come on. I feel like just embrace Something About Mary, Paul.
I guess the only criticism, like I said, is that it's never as good as the first time, and that's really being critical.
Yeah, yeah. I love it. I've seen it as many, many times since. I always enjoy it.
Leisuremen, NBC Sports Radio. Paul Pabst, Andrew Perloff. Big morning of a World Cup tomorrow morning. Starts at 10 a.m. Perloff. Saudi Arabia versus Egypt. Uruguay. Is it Uruguay or Uruguay, Perloff?
You're asking the wrong person. I thought it was Uruguay, but I don't know.
I'm going to go with Uruguay. I think I sound like I know what I'm talking about. Versus Russia, Iran versus Portugal, and then you got the hot one, Spain, Morocco. That probably won't be that great.
Yeah.
Perloff, before we get to Leisuremen approved, not approved in just a few minutes, I was looking at this website called The Muse, some type of hipster website, and they had 15 words you need to eliminate from your vocabulary. We're Leisuremen. We're also somewhat educated men, you more than me, but we're always trying to improve ourselves. I'm going to read you some of these words, and you tell me, you're the English major, you're the Dartmouth guy, yes or no, should we get rid of these from our vocabulary? All right. Honestly, people use the word honestly to add emphasis. The problem is the minute you say, honestly, this is the best hamburger I've ever had, you've implied that the rest of your words were not honest. It's an awkward, unnecessary word.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you're writing like a story for a magazine, you don't want to have honestly in there, but you're not adding anything. Of course you're being honest.
How about conversation?
No, you don't want to use it, but you have to understand, Paul, your whole take is like there's a school of thought that you're being folksy, you're being conversational. Like effective politicians use the word honestly. Like they'll say that So, like, I think the whole point is, like, I feel like language can change. You don't have to be a stickler for being precise. Why do you have to? Yes, it adds nothing. It's a terrible word like that, but
I know language evolves. But aren't there words that annoy you because they're overuse or misuse?
No.
All right, I'm going to give you one. You tell me if this word is overused or misused. Amazing. These Brussels sprouts are amazing. Do you like when you hear people say that at a restaurant?
It doesn't bother me. And I've
No, it doesn't.
I've been there at the table, and I've seen you turn red when people say that stuff. What's wrong? Why can't Brussels sprouts be amazing? I don't understand.
Because they're Brussels sprouts. You know what's amazing? When man lands on the moon. That's amazing. Where I'm actually amazed by what I just saw. Amazed means you're almost like about to pass out. You can't believe what you're seeing. That's the original term of the word. Now it's like buttered bread. It's just so common. The word means causing great surprise or sudden wonder. Amazing has been watered down. It's very bothersome to me.
But you don't like Brussels sprouts. So I don't even know if you could comment on that. What if it was something that you were totally into, like something barbecued or seafood? Then could it be amazing?
Well, barbecue be amazing and often is. All right, next word. Oh, boy. I guess we'll get to this. Irregardless. It doesn't mean what you think. It means regardless. When you say, how would you use irregardless in a sentence?
Is it irregardless like a transition, like where you're talking about one thing and you want to move a irregardless, let's talk about the garden, like something like that, like irregardless is, I don't totally know what it means. Though.
Irregardless means regardless, and you could just use the word regardless. Let's say, so last night it rained like crazy, but regardless, I was inside, so it didn't really matter. That would be the proper way to use it. But somehow, irregardless has snuck into our language.
So what is it? So is it just a misuse?
It's a bastardized word that's unnecessary, Pearl.
Yeah, but if people talk like that, then that's what the... See, this is where we disagree. I'm much more about a language being a living thing that changes every 10 years. Like, when we were kids, remember teenagers used to say the word awesome, and parents were like, that's such a terrible word. Do you remember that at all?
Right.
Everything was awesome.
I guess I want a little bit of discipline.
I just don't agree with you. I sort of like getting in there and mixing it up. There's a reason people talk like that. So wait, the worst though is literally, because my daughter says it every sentence.
Right.
I literally have no idea where the art supplies are.
Literally means I literally was sitting on pins and needles, means there's a chair full of pins and needles and you were physically sitting on it. Like, I was literally on pins and needles waiting to find out the outcome. No, you weren't literally on it. You were figuratively on it. People use literally in place of figuratively or as an emphasizer, according to many different websites. And I did this whole thing on Twitter a couple weeks ago where this girl was saying, I literally pulled my hair out. I was sitting there waiting for my grades to come in. And this girl was next to me, and she had all her hair. So she didn't literally pull it out. She was figuratively pulling her hair out.
Paul, have you ever stopped to consider that maybe you're too harsh on people misusing the English language?
Look, I was a
bad student. In you?
I was a C student. I was actually an honors English in Mr. Waddell's class in high school at Marian Catholic. He would be proud of me. I'm still trying to make him proud. He gave me a C. Then the final word is, and this one is sneaky, the word just. Like when you walk into a restaurant and say, what would you like, sir? I'd just like a little side of ranch with that. Just is a filler word that makes your sentence weaker, and it's a passive word. Not a passive-aggressive word. It's a passive word. Unless, it's being used both improperly and to fill your sentences. Take the word just out of your language.
I'm not going to do that. I'm going to defy it.
Hey, Andrew, do you want to go out and get ice cream after dinner? Nah, I just want to go home. Why don't you say, no, I want to go home. Because we are so passive and afraid to be declarative in how we speak these days.
Yes, because we want people to like us, unlike you, who just wants to be blunt and say everything in four words.
Blunt and disliked is not a bad club to be in.
I can't get down with you on this language police thing. I was at Sports Illustrated, and I know how to edit, like, and take out all the extra words, and I agree with that. Of course, it makes your writing more powerful. But I just don't see it. See what I did there?
You did that.
I literally can't
accent.
Figure out what you're talking about, regardless of where you're headed. Actually, you got these words in my head now. Now they're like just sort of popping out of my mouth.
Well,
honestly,
how about this?
I better stop saying that.
Let me ask your opinion. My daughter says things, and I language police her because I'm trying to have her not fall into these traps. Am I being a jerk parent? Like my daughter goes, Dad, I am so hungry. I'm like, first of all, so doesn't work on its own. I tell her in a nice way. I'm like, you have to say, I'm so hungry that I would like to make my own dinner and not wait for you guys to make it. That would be the proper way of using so, because so doesn't stand on its own.
The proper response for I heard would be, Dad, you are so stupid.
Right. But my daughter, my oldest daughter, Peyton, has kind of caught on. And now when I actually say something like, oh, I'm so tired, and she'll be like, so tired that, and she'll give it right back to me. And we're helping each other out. Or I'm just being a jerk dad.
It's okay. My daughter plays, she says, as if, and then, or she says, Daddy, say as if to me. And I'll say, as if. She goes, as if what, Daddy? You have to finish the sentence. So she set you up. Yeah, no, she's exactly like you. You and Lucy can sit around and language police people to death.
Sounds like a great kid. All right, Leisuremen approved, not approved. I'm going to go right to it because this could be the last broadcast we have before LeBron James makes some type of decision, some type of announcement. Leisuremen approved, not approved. LeBron James is in the home stretch of deciding where he's going to play next year, and his people are currently working every angle and every scenario of free agents to join him either before or after he joins that team, which I believe is the Lakers, but he has already decided the team, barring a disaster where the people can't get there and he goes back to the Cavs. But he's leaving. He has his people working on a project to get the people he wants there, and that's what's going on right now.
Disprove. Who's really? Which free agents? Who? Chris Paul and Paul George?
Yes. Paul George for sure.
Yeah, but Paul George isn't going to want... I can't see him necessarily wanting to do that. Why would he... All right, so Paul George knows LeBron's going to be there. Then you have a Paul George-LeBron team. Is that enough? Is that really interesting?
It might not be enough, Pearl, but you're in L.A. You want to be in L.A.
Yeah.
You're already probably better than Cleveland just by the fact that you don't have to play with J.R. Smith anymore, who's probably untradeable.
I think... First of all, Cleveland, by the way, gelled a lot towards the end of last year. They almost took game one off the Warriors. I don't know that you're better. You're definitely not a better team than Cleveland. They have Kevin Love and George Hill and veterans. So here's the thing. Paul George might want to stay in OKC. It just seems like that's where things might be headed, because at least he's got Russell Westbrook and he's got Melo there, Steven Adams and all. That's kind of a better team than the Lakers. So that's the question. And Chris Paul, the other issue... I don't know if I want to build around Chris Paul as a partner to LeBron.
Okay, secondary Leisuremen approved, not approved. Paul George will join the Lakers if he can by any means possible, because he has played most of his career in somewhat obscurity. You don't know where he went to college. He was really great with the Pacers, then he got hurt, and now he's at OKC and they're doing nothing. He's going to have a great, irrelevant career if he doesn't make a move now.
Yeah, I mean, I understand where you're going from, but I don't know. It just feels like with the Sam Amick report this weekend that Oklahoma City is just as likely as L.A. I just don't know Paul George. He just doesn't seem like a guy that really wants that spotlight. He seems like a quiet guy. So I don't know. I honestly haven't. Do you have any sense of who Paul George is as a person?
No, but I guess everyone wants relevancy. That's just I'm basing this thesis on that.
Now, here's a quote from Sam Amick on USA Today. There's all sorts of optimism in Oklahoma City that George will resign. Conversely, there's pessimism in the James camp that George would leave Oklahoma City. So that's the latest, just a report. It doesn't necessarily mean anything, but I don't know, Paul. I'm just not buying it. Okay, Leisuremen approved, not approved. There is a team out there that everyone is forgetting about that actually could end up being really good next year. Paul, tell me why the San Antonio Spurs do not return to form if they bring Kawhi Leonard back. They'll have LaMarcus Aldridge, Kawhi Leonard, Greg Popovich is a coach. They have a young up-and-coming star guard, DeJounte Murray. They won 61 games 2 years ago. That's a really good team. In fact, if I was LeBron, I would want to go there. They have you know how the Spurs are. Why do we always forget about the Spurs? How come they can't be sweet? Answer me that, Paul.
I agree with you. I'm fully approved that the Spurs way back, because to bet against the Spurs is pretty dumb historically in the past 20 years. I think it's also interesting that nobody is bringing up the Spurs as a team LeBron would join with Greg Popovich, because it's not juicy. You know, it's not the team we want him to go to. We want him to go to L.A. or New York or somewhere juicy like that. So it's not based on basketball analysis. It's based on the fact that the Spurs historically have been kind of a quiet but great team.
I feel like I've read reports that LeBron's not interested in talking. Oh, yeah, Stephen A. said there were seven teams, and I'm not sure. He said that he'll talk to Popovich to be nice, but San Antonio is not a real option. So there has been people. You're right. People think San Antonio is not a city that he would go to if he's considering L.A. because we love San Antonio, but it's not L.A.
Leisuremen approved, not approved. When people on the street, casual or semi-serious NFL